good morning, everybody. Good to be in the house of God this morning. Hope you had a wonderful Thanksgiving. I'm going to go ahead and start off by just mentioning most of you know that last week my wife was diagnosed with a glioma, a tumor in her brain, and that was removed yesterday, most of it, and we'll have further treatments. And missing her right now, but I'll be seeing her right after we do this. I'm going to run back to the hospital and be with her and be back tonight. But the blessing in all this is just the amount of support and love I've seen here at this church. My amazing family just coming through and friends. It's just, I just had to say thank you. Take advantage of this standing up here and just say thank you. And if I stop singing here and there today, I'll be okay. But you just keep on singing and we're just going to worship together. Let's stand together here.
Hallelujah, all praise. Good morning, church. It sure is good to see you following the Thanksgiving holidays. Joel Davila, good to see you, brother. Joel and Mark Skelton are back with us from their 10 days down in Florida. Thank you, brother. Mark happens to be in my Bible study class, so we were able to give him a little time to give us the Reader's Digest version. I'd sure for you and Joel, both you guys, we would sure like to hear from you in whatever way works for you. I know neither one of you are probably just dying to grab the microphone and run up here, and I appreciate that, but maybe we can put down on paper and stick in next week's bulletin your words, your feelings, your expressions. I know you had some good experience actually being out with people and seeing the actual good that Southern Baptists do when they feed people who are homeless, and others that are there serving the homeless. So thank you. Welcome back, fellas. Also, you may notice things look a little stark around here. Matter of fact, it looks downright dirty most of the places. Have you noticed that? I walked in and started picking up leaves, as I just made my way across one part of the auditorium. Our youth were here yesterday, probably over half the day, getting ready for the service that we're going to have tonight. We have a Hanging of the Green service that takes place. If you've not seen it, let me talk to you just a minute. Those of you who've been here know what a blessing it is. It's a unique event. We don't do anything like it all year long. It's strictly a musical event, generally speaking. And as we sing Christmas carols and wonderful songs, our youth get all dressed up and bring in all the decorations that will fill this altar all around, everywhere. And it's a beautiful auditorium when it's decorated, lit up as well with lights. So if you got an hour tonight, show up at 6. It's a blessing. And if you want to just really enjoy people of your church family, grab a few cookies if you can remember it. Cook a few, buy a few, I don't care, and just show up. Deacons they want us to hang around and meet people and spend time together, just fellowshipping. We don't always get to see people, and so what a great time. After that service, we'll just kind of, we're not going to put tables and chairs. Don't come for supper. All right? You're not going to make a meal out of chocolate chip cookies. We're not going to let you do that to yourself. But you can have a cookie or two and coffee or hot chocolate, those kind of things. You come and just fellowship. The point is fellowship, not nutrition. But we know how you Baptists are. So, all right, let's go to the Lord, shall we? Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we are so thankful to be a part of the body of Christ and so humbled that you have called us. Lord, that you've chosen us. Lord, not because we're any better than anyone, but in sovereignty, you chose us. And Lord, we want to maximize that, both in this life and the one to come. And so, Father, we're here for that very purpose, to hear from you, our King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Lord, speak to our hearts through your word. We can count on your word. Preachers can be questionable, but your word never falters, never fails, never leaves us, never forsakes us, always faithful to tell us the truth about ourselves, our heart, our condition, where we are, our motives. And so, God, I pray that even today, as you speak through a passage of your scripture, that we would hear from you. Our ears would be inclined to you, that our hearts would be open and humble learners, that we would hear and soak up like sponges everything you tell us. In just a few verses, Lord, it can transform our life, the smallest portion of your word. And so, Father, give us ears to hear, heart to embrace, Lord, and a mind to exhilarate in the truth of what you tell us. And Father, we'll be careful to give you the praise and give you the glory for this day. And Father, we pray it all in the strong and precious name of Jesus. Amen. If you happen to be visiting with us today, welcome. We're sure glad you're here. Sometimes Thanksgiving, relatives get drugged to church. So if that's your case, we're glad someone drug you here today. Even if you didn't want to come, we're still glad you're here. This is the Lord's house. He'll speak to your heart if you let him. And these people aren't all that bad when you get to know them. you know. So give them a chance. Give them a chance. They have a way of growing on you, and it's good. You're also welcome to fill out a card. We have cards in the chair in front of you. If you just want to give us a name, address, email, whatever, we'd be happy to communicate with you. For now, why don't we just stand together and let's just shake hands with those that are worshiping around us.
Music, that's fantastic. You may be seated just for a few moments. I have to share this about my wife, if you'll indulge me. It's the brain tumor has been a very interesting experience because she is 100% aware. She's 100% personality is all there. She knows everything that's going on, but because it affects her motor skills in her right arm, right leg, she can't use those, and she cannot communicate as far as speech. She can't type. Because it just doesn't make any sense to her, you know. But she can say yes and no, and she can squeeze your hand, and she can laugh and she can cry. She's all there, but it's just there's this break between communication. It's fascinating, and it amazes me. A side note, it amazes me all the more that people think the brain is just an evolved thing. It's just way too amazing for that. But a funny story. About every hour, every 2 hours, they'll come in and check to see how she's doing as far as progressing up or down, and they'll make her raise her hand and leg, wiggle her fingers, wiggle her toes, and stick her tongue out, smile, that kind of thing. And so they have her shake her two fingers in her left hand, and she can do that, and she can raise her left leg, and they get to her right hand and say, can you wiggle your two fingers on your right hand? And she can't right now, so they held up her hand in front of her face and say, on this hand, can you wiggle these fingers? And she just had them up there, and she brought up her left hand and wiggled her fingers. We know that we have this peace and love, even though a little bit of sadness and sorrow right now, we are drowned out by his peace and joy.
Oh, the Lord, our strength and song, highest praise to him belongs. Christ the Lord, our conquering King, your name we raise. Your triumph. His hand we
Save
Amen. Our children's worship is going on. That's where some of these folks are going to. If your child is in first through sixth grade, they may benefit from being in our children's worship. And they will have them for you in the foyer when we're done and when they're done. Thank you, Derek, and choir and orchestra. They are heading into the busiest month of their life. They're going to be performing not only here, but at other venues as well. And if you're one of those that want to stalk them and go to all of their performances, we can get you that information. You call the office and we'll see that you know all the dates and the times when they'll be performing. If you pick up the full Bible, Old and New Testaments, and just let it fall in half, you'll find yourself most of the time in the book of Psalms. The book of Songs occupies the center place, the middle of our Bibles. And all the way, if you read the all 150 of those songs that God's given us and put in our Bibles, if you read through them, through even the most sorrowful songs, the most tragic places, you have the feeling that you're like walking on a smoldering volcano of praise that's liable to burst out in any moment into a great flame of gratitude to God. And so it's not a surprise, really, as you get to the end of Psalms, to come to the last five songs that are very unique in the book of Psalms. You come to the last five, they're unlike the rest of them, in that each one of those five songs begin with the Hebrew word, hallelujah, and they conclude with that same word, hallelujah. And of all five of those songs, some total 59 verses in all, you read all five of those songs, the songwriter does not ask for one thing. Nothing is requested of God. 59 verses of praise to the Almighty. We translate the Hebrew word, praise the Lord. You've sang both hallelujah and you've sang praise the Lord numerous times already as we've prepared to receive God's word. The author of these five songs, he is content to just look on, to admire, to wonder, and to adore God. He's happy just to bask in the knowledge, historical record, personal relationship he experiences with God Almighty. And perhaps all of us have been at a great musical performance. I think it's pretty great what we do here at Christmas time. I know it's Derek's love of the year to bring our Christmas special to us. And certainly he's right up there with other orchestra leaders, directors. And so maybe you've been at a musical performance, and maybe somewhere in the performance your eyes fixated on the director. You just kind of got distracted by watching his motions and how he commands all of these voices and all of these instruments, and how with the slightest little look he gives cues or the slightest touch of his baton, something changes. And you quickly realize this man is leading all of these people, and they all are watching him for their cues. The entire musical performance is hinging upon his directions, upon his actions. And you've been at one of those performances where when some people are singing and some instruments are playing, and then you notice that he begins to bring in others that are not playing. And then there's others who are not singing, and he begins to bring them in. And all together, they begin to combine together. Before long, all of them are playing, and all of them are singing. And it comes to this beautiful crescendo as he leads them all together. In the same way, I think, these final songs, they summon all of creation to swell in the glorious unison of God's praise. Have you ever wondered what it'd be like? Just for one day, for one minute, for one hour, everybody on the whole earth, everything on the whole earth was compelled to stop doing what they were doing and to just praise God. Even if they just looked up and raised their hands and opened their mouths and said, praise God. Hey, can you just imagine? I was thinking as we sang about the numbers of people. If you've ever been a part of a large choir, if you've ever been part of I keep referring to the Promise Keepers because that's the largest one I think I can remember. You know, 80,000 men in a stadium will leave an impression on your mind after being with them for a couple of days. And that masculine voice resonating, you know, it's hard to get out of your head. And that's just 80,000 people. That's nothing. It's not even a peep out of what the world's population would be capable of. Or even just the redeemed singing and turning to God in praise. These five songs look up and they see the sun as it travels the course in the sky, and it calls out to the sun and says, you come now and praise him. It looks up at the night sky, at the myriad of stars, and it says, you now praise him. Then the mountains that are raking the clouds with their summits, and they say, praise him. And then the kings and the judges of the earth, the psalmist calls to praise God. The young men and the strong women are called upon to praise God. And then to believers in the earth, these songs say, praise him, until the entire universe is engulfed and shouting with every voice the praise of God alone. The very first of those five songs, the 146th song, inspired the famous Isaac Watts to write his hymn, I'll Praise My Maker While I Have Breath. And in this song, the 146th song, there are six personal pronouns in the first two verses. And that's where we're going to camp. But we can't ignore the rest of these eight verses. You know, so I want us to give respect to the rest of the psalm. But I'd like for us to live this morning and what little bit of time y'all give me to these first two verses. I'll just give you a heads up that this songwriter is going to praise God, whether anybody else does or not, right? I've been in churches like that where, well, if nobody else is going to praise the Lord, I am. If I have to show these people in their house of how to worship, I'll do it. I will sing. It may not be pretty, and it may not be on key or pitch, but they'll have no doubt that there's a follower of Christ who believes in praising the Lord as best he can. A lot of times it inspires them to start singing because they can do better. And just for the sake of everyone, join in, pitch in. You know, otherwise this guy's going to kill our whole worship service. We're here in America, we're all about excellence. We're all about perfection and all of it. You know, I mean, it's so ridiculous. We're such flawed individuals. The idea that we produce anything perfect is laughable. And that our singing would be perfect, that our musical performance, it's all ridiculous. It's the object of the one we worship that steals our heart. You know, if we could hear ourselves, we'd probably stop singing, right? You know, oh my gosh, if someone like that was next to me, I wouldn't sing at all. It'd bother me so much, you know? But I don't know that. I can't hear that. I hear Derek sing. So I just sing all the more, right? I'm listening to Derek lead us. I sound great. So I belt it out. This songwriter's going to praise the Lord, but he knows that everyone else and everything should too. In this song, he's going to address 10 types of people that I think represent everybody. We're all in this 146th psalm in one way or another, sooner or later. And there's also 12 verbs in these 10 verses, and they all teach us what the occupation of our life should be to continually praise God. And the duration of that praise should be as long as we live. We don't get too old to say, praise the Lord. We're never too young to say, hallelujah. Let's look at it. Psalm 146. This is the New King James translation if yours is different. Praise the Lord, or hallelujah. Praise the Lord, O my soul. While I live, I will praise the Lord. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being. Do not put your trust in princes, nor in a son of man, in whom there is no help. His spirit departs, he returns to his earth. In that very day, his plans perish. Happy is he who has the God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord his God, who made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, who keeps truth forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord gives freedom to the prisoners. I think you may have sung something about this. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord raises those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the strangers. He relieves the fatherless and widow. But the way of the wicked, he turns upside down. The Lord shall reign forever. Your God, O Zion, to all generations. Hallelujah. Well, I hope that warms something in your heart, church, or we're in trouble. While I live, cries the psalmist, I will praise the Lord. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being. Now, before we focus on those words, let me just fly over those eight verses. They are pointed. They are straightforward. There's no cultural explanation needed. There is no Mideastern accoutrements that need to be understood first. It's as plain and clear in every culture and every tongue. I don't mean to insult you, but I just want to put it together in a nutshell as we then focus on those first two verses. In verses 3 and 4, he says, don't put your trust, church, in powerful people, because people are undependable at best, and they are mortal. They die, and their plans die with them. Whatever they promised you, whatever you thought you might get, they're going to drop dead sometime. Don't put your trust in people, because people are dust, and they are going to return to the dust, and death is standing at the door of their life while they live. Put your trust in the God of the Bible, in verse 5, for his help, both right now and forevermore. And he says, you will be happy. Right there, simple words from God to you this morning about your happiness. Verse 6, instead of being the dust like powerful people, God created the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that dwells in them. He's faithful, and the universe depends upon him for its continued existence. It cannot continue the way you know it. The cosmos will not continue unless God deems it so, hour by hour and minute by minute. Every day you look up and see those things, you know it's always been that way. Yes, but it may not be that way in another minute if God so chooses. It's dependent. It's structured. It very exists because he spoke it into existence. And at any moment it can be taken away. In verses 7 through 10, make no mistake about it. You'll get a lot of appeals for people wanting you to give them money, ministries and others, at the end of this time of year while you're feeling great about Christmas. But make no mistake about it, God alone gives justice to the oppressed. Food to hungry people, freedom to prisoners. He opens blind eyes. He raises the bowed down. He loves the righteous. He watches over strangers. He relieves the orphan and the widow. And he turns the way of the wicked upside down. Verse 10, the Lord your God will reign forever. Your God, O Zion, to all generations, hallelujah. Now, let me make some comments. I know some of you, that's good enough, you're ready to go, but if you'll give me a minute or two, I'd like to, give me a second. Let me see if I can warm your heart a little more and maybe challenge you. Wherever you have authentic Christianity, be sure of this. The dominant note will always be praise. Wherever you have authentic Christianity, the dominant note will always be praise. When you guys sent me to Africa, and the first African village in the middle of nowhere, little old tiny place, little old grass hut thing, wasn't even big enough for all of us. We had to go out in the field, sit on a log in order to teach. I ended up in the women's class somehow. I don't know how that was. I guess God wanted me there. You know, I'm sitting there trying to follow what's going on and be there. But I tell you, it was unmistakable, the note of that authentic group of believers. It was dirt on the ground, and they didn't have much on their backs. But let me tell you, praise was in their hearts. They were a praising people. When I gathered with Chinese in small rooms, not public places, in their faces, there was praise. In their words, there was song. Authentic Christianity always has as its dominant note the note of praise. There's more praise in Christianity than in all world religions combined, put together. I mean, come on, look and consider with me and be honest. Islam knows very little about praise. Some religions know how to wield the sword, but they don't know anything about how to play the harp. Stoics know how to be rugged, but they're wretched when it comes to singing. New Agers can meditate, but they don't know jack about hallelujahs. And it's praise that differentiates Christianity and sets it apart yet again. How many times do we come to this? How many times can we view Christianity from how many facets, from so many directions, and see how it is unique among everything that anybody has ever believed anywhere in the world? It stands, it dominates the religious world. It always has and it always will, because the truth of God revealed in history that our forefathers saw it and realized it to be what it was. In reality, it is praise that sets us apart. We who know something of the difference that Christ makes in our hearts ought to say so better than the Old Testament saints. Your praise ought to be better than what you read in the Old Testament. You have greater revelation of God in Christ than they ever could dream of. You saw, listened, observed Him walk and talk and move and lead. You have greater understanding than how many millions of people, tens of millions of people, because of the place you occupy in this chronological world of ours. You should be superior to them in what you're able to bring and voice and speak to God. While I live, I will praise the Lord. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being. As believers, our first and last responsibility, I believe, is praise. To say so. Can I just tell you, transparently, be honest with you just a second, because I don't know why I remember this, but it was a milestone in my Christian walk. The day I started saying publicly, unashamed, unafraid, in front of believers and unbelievers, well, praise the Lord. Or, well, hallelujah. I never used to say that. That was a little bit too Jesus-y for me, a little bit too much God. Someone say something would happen, you know, would come in with great news. I'm, wow, that's great. Wow, that's neat. And the day I decided to start giving God credit for the good things that he brings, instead of keeping it to myself, it was just a deliberate, just a decision I made. You know what? If something good happens, I tell you, God had something to do with it. Whether anybody knows it or not, it's irrelevant. And he did it. And as someone who knows that all good gifts, perfect gifts come from God, I should be the one to say so among the dummies, right? They're clueless. Oh, look at this great thing. I was so lucky. I was standing there. Well, praise the Lord. I put a whole new dimension on that. Maybe God had something. Maybe he made it personal for you. He's that kind of God. It's like him to do things like that. He does it in my life. And I know he does it in yours, even though you're too ignorant to recognize him, to acknowledge his presence. You know, catch up. Catch up with the rest of the world. Our God loves us. He works in our behalf always. I also think that our praying, praise always finds its way into our prayers. You notice that? I can ask somebody to pray for the most difficult thing, the fires going on in California, people that are missing, families that don't know. And I ask somebody, will you pray for that? And you just watch and wait. No matter how they pray, they're going to come back to thanking God. Thanking God ahead of time of what he's going to do. In the absence of anything to thank him about, they'll thank him because he's going to do something that in time we'll look back on and say, oh, look what God did. We were blind to it at the time, but look what God did. Look how he revealed himself. It's just absolutely a part of everything we do, and certainly a part not only of our personal prayer life, but in our corporate times of prayer. You know, Derek got out here and made himself vulnerable and shared the hardest thing that man's ever been called upon by God to do. What did he say? Did he mention any thanks in there? Yeah. I think he recognized that in his wife's journey in these last few weeks were strikingly marked by the presence of God in the darkest of places and hospitals where glory fills the room. Because you at home prayed and said, God, would you have mercy on Melissa? Will you give Derek strength to weather what's unimaginable? And he stood there and he showed up here this morning. And nobody told him to be here. We had backup, multiple backups. Derek, do what you need to do, brother. We love you. Melissa needs you there. You stay there and keep holding her hand. Like you've been holding her hand and your family's been holding her hand this whole time. Never leaving her side. Never letting her think she's alone in the hospital. Standing guard. Telling her how great her God is. More gathered in the waiting room praying, talking of the goodness and the greatness of God. Take our hymns and our songs. What's the keynote? The keynote's always praise. You know, sometimes you don't get that around Christians. You can get around a group of Christians and they don't talk like that. They don't ever say praise the Lord. They don't ever say thank you, Jesus. It's like they're scared or they're afraid or maybe they don't believe it's God that did those good things. I don't know. I just know that whatever day, however old I was, I have no recollection. I just remember it was a set-free moment when I decided I'd give God credit. I don't care if anybody around me liked it, didn't like it. I don't care what they think. You know, I talk, I'm going to talk. You know what I'm going to say? I'm going to bless God with it. How can a believer be silent? How can we in the New Testament era, the church era, the last era, how on earth can we keep quiet of all people of the world? I understand in the dark ages maybe it was tough. Or maybe when there wasn't much light. I understand. Maybe just keeping it quiet. But I tell you, here and now, nobody ought to be keeping their mouths shut. We're talking resurrection power here. We're talking about a heaven that's being suited and framed and built and equipped and prepared by the loving hands that stretched out on that cross for us. That's my future. That's where I am headed sooner than later these days. It's coming. I'm starting to lean on the other direction of life. Body's falling apart. Brain's failing me. I'm getting closer. 60 years, I've earned a little bit closer to that day and to that hour. What a day of rejoicing that will be. We ought to stand on tiptoe, church, and sing with every fiber of our spiritual being that the evil empire quivers when we sing. When we say praise the Lord, we say hallelujah, we sing hallelujah. Hallelujah chorus is a part of that great, masterful piece that we without fail want to hear from at least a few times at the Christmas season. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Is not the central part of worship praise? Is that not the heart of what you want to do? Isn't it the heart of a personal love relationship with Jesus to praise Him? What is a relationship with Christ if it's not gratitude? If you don't know Jesus, I get it. You don't understand that. I don't fault you for that. I wasn't grateful for Him either until I became grateful for Him. Until I realized what He had done for me. Until I realized that cross experience was all for me. It was sufficient for me, and it was all for me. If no one else wanted to go to heaven with Him, I was on board, and it was done for me. A lot of other people can benefit from it because it was done for them too. But that was the expression of love that God sealed once and for all. I love you, and I give my life for you, that you may be where I am, that you may behold my glory. You haven't gotten all of God yet. You haven't seen a portion of Him yet. You've not even touched the hem of the garment of what God has for you. Does that not excite you? Can you not praise Him here in this place? And every time we gather, there are those whose natural condition is to be grumbly. Some of you are converted grumblers. Now, truly, I'm just talking plain truth. Some people just grumble. It's what they do. You know, maybe they were taught that by their mom and dad incidentally. They just did a lot of grumbling in their life, and so the kids pick it up. And they do grumbling. Grumbling's contagious. The Bible says that. Unholiness is contagious. You bump into it, you rub against it, and sure enough, it gets off on you. And you become one of those. Nearly everyone passes through stages of grumbliness in their lives. Even the high spirit Reformation voice of the great Martin Luther had his moments. He said once, "The world is an evil fellow. Let's hope God will soon end him." We all go through times when the fountains of praise and gratitude dry up. I confess it, I confess it, I confess it. There are moments leading up to things where I just feel praise and gratitude just draw like the tide rolling away from me. As I begin to have other feelings and thoughts, it begins to withdraw from me. I know that. And for some people, they have lifetime trials. People in this auditorium have close people in their family and lives that don't know Jesus. Or if they knew Him, they jumped ship and quit on Him. And they're forever praying for them. They're always in a state of discontent because of lost people and people that are important to them who are going to bust hell wide open unless something changes. And there's a sense in which they can't ever get free of that. And it holds them. And they worry themselves about these things. They want to see it come to an end now. But church, I tell you, if you only focus on the difficulties, if you only focus on the unfinished blessings that God has in your life, you're judging things before they're in. You're dragging down what eventually may be the greatest blessing in your life, but you're suffering for it all along leading up to that. I tell you that it is important for us not to get mad at God. Tomorrow, it may all be different. And certainly, ultimately, many things will be different. I tell you, don't focus on those things. And don't let Him hold your mouth. Let the devil keep you quiet. The grateful, praising spirit of the believer is part of making the right choices in life. We ought not to total up our disadvantages until we've sat down first to count our mercies. Till you get all grumbly, have you appropriately counted the mercies, the graces that He's bestowed on you? I can't think of one thing that can come to the human being's life, the believer's life, that I cannot give you a longer list of what he's done already in giving his son, in giving you life, in creating you uniquely. I can give you a whole long list. For whatever bad thing you think is so awful, you're not looking at the whole scorecard. You're not reading it rightly. You're being duped by the devil, and you're majoring on the minors, and you're not doing yourself any favor, and you're probably not much of a blessing to everybody else. We ought not to total all that junk up until we sit down and count our blessings and, yeah, name them one by one. Look at the providences of God. It's our responsibility to look at the good first. I repeat, they're always, the good is always there. If you have eyes to see it, it's there. The bad thing happens, and we all get focused on it and talk about it. Well, let's back up and see what good preceded that. What led up to that? Because the truth is, what led up to that is more likely to be the case after this thing, whatever it is, happens. Odds are this will too shall pass. And where will we be then? We'll be in better places, higher places, more mature places, more tested places, better developed character places, more perseverance places, all kinds of the great things God does when he brings those hard things in our life. We have reason to praise him for what's going to happen after the trial. And so, I guess I'm trying to tell you that even the darkest night has stars in it. It's the Christian person who fixes not on the darkness, but on the stars. And especially that one bright morning star that's always shining. You know, when depression comes, open your New Testament. Read, imagine. Take your Bible and ask God to show it to you like you've never seen it before. Follow the Gospels. Turn to the Gospels and throw yourself into the story. Stand beside one of the disciples and watch and listen to the Lord. Imaginably put yourself there and think what it would have been like if you would have been there, if it had been a part of your life, if you would have stood there and heard Jesus and listened to his word. You look around on the people that are there and how they act so much like we do. People are not different. They're just like you and I. If we were there, we'd say, you know, that reminds me of so-and-so. And you know that? Yeah, that looks just like so-and-so. It's the same forever. Put yourself back in that New Testament and look around. Look at over the Sea of Galilee. Those little pea-sized fishing vessels that are floating there. And the common fishermen that occupy those vessels. Look out at Bethany and see Lazarus and Mary and Martha, who are so good to our Lord in hospitality, letting him come, being friends to him, a safe place for him to come and stop and visit and be with them. Look at the upper room and those disciples scared and frightened. Crucified Christ, and there they sit, fear of what's going to happen to them next. Listen to Jesus' words. Watch his actions. Listen to his calmness. Remember what he did for you. The Son of God loves you and gave himself for you. See if a passion of praise doesn't cast out your depression and give joy to your soul. While I live, I will praise the Lord. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being. What is a discipline and a virtue to train ourselves to fix our attention on the mercies rather than the troubles, we still haven't done our best until we can praise God. Ready for this? For everything. For everything. You haven't done your best praise so you can thank God for everything. Everything. And most of the time you'll be thanking him, praising him, even though you don't know why. I praise you, Lord, for a tumor in Melissa Millsap's brain. I give you glory. I give you honor. You had charge over it. You had say over it. You had dominion over it. And you said yes. I give you praise. I don't do it very excitedly. I don't do it very enthusiastically. But then I haven't been shown the whole picture. And I judge things with these eyes. I judge things with this human heart. And it bites me every time. Every time. You don't have to let it bite you. You can rise above. You can give God thanks for everything that comes. Both clouds and sunshine and darkness and stars. That's the heart of these songwriters, of these psalmists. These are men who stand on the road of common everyday life and cry, "Praise the Lord!" Not mindlessly, not some village idiot, but the greatest discernment and wisdom of the ages. Whoever you are, wherever you're going, whatever's happened, whatever's come to you, lift your voice and praise the Lord. It's the wisest, smartest, best thing you can conceivably do at any day and time in your life. Shout it out, praise the Lord. You stand over the hospital bed and say, praise the Lord. Stand by the grave and whisper, praise the Lord. Church, faith's victory is praise from the depths. Anybody can say praise the Lord if the lottery is mistakenly given to you because you don't gamble. Easy to say praise the Lord for $1 billion. Appreciate it, Lord. Right? But when they say your wife has a brain tumor, how much singing do you do then? How easy is it for you to get up from the floor and say, God, I praise you. While I have breath, while I have being, I'll praise you. I'll praise you in the storm. I'll praise you in the rain. I'll praise you as my blood comes out of my body. I'll live for you. I'll die for you. I'll give it all to you. I'll leave it all here for your glory, God, for you and for you alone. It is that grateful praising Christ who can make us sons of praise like He Himself. Remember that. He took that bread and that wine with His men. And as He broke that bread, He knew exactly what it meant. Take this, break this. It's my body that's about to be broken for you. That's about to be given to you. And then after all of the indignities of that cup and what looking into that cup and what it was going to mean and what it was going to signify, His death. And after doing the Lord's Supper, He gave God thanks for what was yet to be. And then after giving thanks for that broken body and that blood, the Bible says they went out in the garden and they sang a song. When the call comes that you're going to die soon, do you go out and sing a song? Sing a song. Because you know, because you get it, because you've read this book, because you believe it's the Word of God, and you live it every moment of every day, and you give thanks to God as if it was a normal day, a regular day. Men and women who found the secret of a fortitude stronger than pain, a peace unshaken by the assaults of doubt, and of a joy that smiles through the blinding tears of defeated dreams and the bitterest disappointments that human hearts can possibly know. It is only Jesus who can guarantee the soul's victory. He can make us strong in the face of anything and everything to praise the Lord, to sing praises to our God while we have being. Hear this. Praise is our responsibility to God. When Jesus healed the 10 lepers, how many came back? And what did Jesus have to say about it? Where are the other 9? Did they not receive healing? Did they not get the blessing from God? But they just kept it. It didn't mean anything. They were thankful. They took it like thieves, and they ran. 10% had the good sense, the humility to come back. Isaiah watched his nation fall away from God. And God asked him, ask Isaiah, what more could I have done for my people? What else? What did I leave undone that my people should behave this way? What could I have done in my vineyard than what I did already? Jesus told some sour, jealous people during his triumphal entry into Jerusalem on the colt of a donkey that if these people did not praise God, the rocks would. Praise was required at the moment. And if human beings cannot find it, do not discern it, then from inanimate life, God will have praise. The rocks will cry out. They will celebrate Him. After what Jesus has already done for you and me, if our hearts aren't throbbing with gratitude and praise, the stones near our houses may cry out against us, ingrate. Praise is also our responsibility to ourselves. Praise and obedience, church, are great healers. Your heart hurting this Thanksgiving, Christmas season? There's not a season that comes, church. We don't have people that this is a reminder. It's the first time of a tremendous loss, the reminder of another kind of loss. Everyone's excited and everyone's happy, and yet there's a palpable coldness and toughness in the air. Despite all the gaiety, there exists there because a reminder of bad things and of hard things. It's in every one of our celebrations. It's in all of that. But I tell you, praise and obedience are the greatest healers. You don't want to come to the Hanging of the Green because you're sad. That's the reason why you come to the Hanging of the Green. Go home and pout and cry. Come here and sing the great songs and truths of the faith. Come watch these young people who are going to become something in their life. It'll be chiseled and molded in some degree by who we are to them. And we appreciate them and celebrate. They're part of our family and the prospect of their great lives. Come and watch. It won't happen long. It won't happen very often. Don't miss that. And you just may find in the glorious merry singing of the great hymns of the faith, your whole heart may break forth and sing. Your lips may move to the glory of God, even while your heart's grumbling. When life grows sore and wounding, it's difficult to praise God. I know it. I'm ashamed. I'm ashamed of the way I acted when they told me my daughter had Friedreich's ataxia. I'm not proud of that day. You don't know anything about it, probably. I was in my office. I was at my desk doing what God's called me to do and what you so graciously let me do. And I had a real problem with God allowing that in my daughter's life. I was mad. My first instinct, church, I tell you the truth, to my shame, I tell you, I almost put my pen down and got up out of that chair and walked out of that door right there and got in my car and drove away and never see me again. I was ready to quit on the Lord. I'd given Him everything, and I'd given Him everything to my dying breath, and He takes the health of my daughter. And I was done. And my heart wanted to quit on Him. The phone rang, and the chairman, the head guy, the president of Johnny and Friends was on Doug Mazza on the other phone. His son, I've met his son. His son is in a tough way physically. He doesn't have the relationship with his son that I have with my daughter. He says, Mark, I heard the news. But I want you to know, brother, for standing with you. For standing with you. You know how much strength came through that phone to hear a man who suffers far greater than what God's asked me to suffer. Tells me, stand strong, brother. Stand strong. Eyes are on you. When the bad news comes, people start looking at you. Is it real? What you have, what you preach, what you say, is it real? Let's see you do it. You tell us to praise the Lord in everything. You tell us to praise God when my wife has a brain tumor. What do? When they tell you your daughter likely won't walk, she won't move by herself. How happy are you, Pastor? Can you say praise the Lord? While I live, while I have my being, I'll praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'll praise Him. All right. Lastly, and I'm done, praise is our responsibility, church, to others. You have a responsibility to praise God for the benefit of others, for them to hear it come out of your mouth, genuinely, authentically. Christian praise, church, I tell you, is a contagious property about it. Because it's genuine, it's real, it's the real deal. One heart touches another, and then one spark leaps to one another. One person who praises God with his soul can start others who had no intention of praising the Lord. Their thoughts weren't going to thank you, Jesus. Someone in the back of the room begins to sing, "It's well with my soul." Before long, somebody else finally comes and joins in. And nobody wants to sing it. Nobody's feeling it. Somebody does. Somebody has the courage and knows the recipe for this kind of situation is to lift your heart. And they begin to sing a song of praise. It may be whispered. It may not be on key either. But they know the words and they begin to sing. And somebody else. And before long, the most resolute, upset person can begin to mime the words of that great truth of giving God glory and giving Him praise in those places and in those times. Keep sounding your note of praise even when you least know it, and others will be facing life more courageously because of you. Don't do it just in your closet. Do it in your closet. You can be a radical fanatic in your closet before the lost world. Live authentically. Live who you are, and God will show them a difference. He will reveal the faith that lives in your heart. While I have life, I'll praise God. While I have breath, I will sing God's glory. While I have my being, it's going to be about Him. If you can't do that honestly and sincerely here, each one of you, if I talk to you individually, if you can't do that, I tell you, there's something tragically wrong. And I would implore you not to leave this church. If you think, you know, Pastor, I'm just of a more different persuasion than you Southern Baptist. And we don't do that. I question your salvation. I ask you to go back and consider that you, in fact, did give your life and all to the one who died for you. Let's talk about that. And in light of all these words, of all these books, you don't. Let's pray. Father, I thank you. Lord, I give you glory. Lord, I want to sing when it's easy to sing here in church. And Father, I want to sing. It may be not quite as good, may not be quite as loud. But Father, I want to sing to you when the worst things happen. Lord, I want to know, I want others to know that while I feel like I have been dealt a blow from the hand of the devil, that it's nothing more than love coming into my life in a way I never imagined and never expected. That God's calling me to a test. He's giving me a discipline. He's calling out to the deep depths of my life and my soul to say, Mark, can you rise above the worst that happens on this planet for the glory of God? Do you really, really believe what you say? And is it alive in your heart today? And do the people around you know it? If not, let's talk, let's visit, let's pray. Let's open afresh these words of life and listen to the one who came and said, I am the way and the truth and the life, and there's no man will come to the Father except by me. And come to terms with Him. How we live to tell you how we got there. And anybody can come. Father, move our hearts as only you can. Touch us, God, as only you can. Communicate with us in our unique brains and experiences, Lord, as only you can. And bring us to Christ. And keep us by Christ. And keep Him on our lips for all to hear. Not in show, not in some artificial manipulation, but out of the genuineness of our walk with you, the greatest one. And Father, we'll give you praise, we'll give you glory here. Oh, and how we'll sing there. Oh, how we will sing there. We pray in Christ's name, amen. If you'd like to stand, Derek's going to lead us, I think. Nope, Alan's going to lead us, sorry. I think Derek's probably where he needs to be. Y'all stand. Alan will lead us. And we'll sing, and Steve's here. I'm here. If we can help, you come. You're welcome to be a part of this family.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you. And here I am to worship, here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, for so here I am. together worthy, all together wonderful to me. Here I am to worship.
Here I am to bow down.
Here I am to say that you're
Church. What a great way to put a bow on our time together. Worship attendants, well, almost a bow. Worship attendants are coming because they're still the bow of our financial giving. If you haven't participated in that yet, that's even a better bow as you materially, physically demonstrate and give to God what is His. Let's pray. Father, thank you that we can give to you. Thank you, God, that money makes a difference in eternity, and that we can make our contribution, Lord. We're all mindful of the Lottie Moon Christmas offering, Lord. This month of December, coming month of December, Lord, it's our one time all year of just giving solely to missionaries and work around the world in every country, God. And we want to be a part of that to whatever degree you let us. And so, Father, help us to do that very thing. Help us to be intentional and prepare for that, Lord. And we'll be careful to give you the praise and the glory. Thank you for this gift we're receiving for this church, Lord. Use it, multiply it, protect it for your kingdom's good, we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Well, I just would say to you that there's been much I've learned here today, and out of our Bible study this morning, we're told to be patient, until the Lord comes. That's living in by faith in all things and praising God for what He will do when He comes and makes everything right. If you don't know that in your heart, I just invite you after we close in just a few minutes and everybody's walking out. I'll be right down here at the front of the auditorium. I'd love to talk to you about that. We'll have some of our prayer team right over here on this side. Maybe there's something that you need to lift up to the Lord this morning in prayer and give it over to God. And I invite you to do that before you leave this place today. Just a few things in your bulletin. Make sure you read your bulletins, especially this time of year. There is so much going on in this church. Remember the new couples and parents Bible study class that's going to start next Sunday morning, 9:15. Remember it in your prayers. If you know a young couple or a young parent, bring them. Get them to come. Try it out. Let's see what God will do here in this place. Also, in your bulletin, you'll see all of our holiday events on Sunday evenings and what's going on each Sunday evening. Out there on the Welcome Center desk, there's little cards that have these same events on them. Pick up a handful of those. Take them home with you. Give them out to your neighbors. Invite them to come. Give them a ride. You know, bring them on down. And let's praise God with this glorious season when we celebrate the coming of our Lord. Tonight, we're going to be beginning the one who's right at the top of the list there. We'll have the hanging of the green at 6 o'clock tonight. Invite a friend, bring a relative, come this evening. This is where we kind of get our hearts right for the season. You know, let's get our hearts and our minds where we need to be as we enter into this season of celebration. And invite you to come. We're going to have cookies afterward. Mark already talked to you about those things where we can fellowship just a little bit. Let's stand. And let's go to the Lord one more time here this morning. Father, we do lift up your name in praise, Lord God, because you are able to do all things. Lord, we know that there's never anything that happens in our lives that you can't handle and that you do not control. Lord, we trust in you and we live our lives, Lord, in faith and trust in you through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And we will stand forever in eternity giving praise to you, knowing that not one of us would be there with you except for what you have done in laying down your life and paying the price for my sins and for our sins. Lord Jesus, we lift up your name in praise forever and ever. And it's in your great name that we say these things and that we have this great hope in us. Amen.